kitchen, just add the slide.
Good morning, students. Today we are going to learn about a pandemic that has shook the world in 541 AD, starting its first pandemic there. And today the day is about the corona. We are facing the problem. This is the pandemic currently ruling us. So as you recollect this advertisement in your younger days, this is Martin Radkill, which gives you an introduction that this disease like pneumonic plague, jaisi khatarnak bimari ani ok ad that was being displayed by this Martin fellow, and that is just for your brief introduction, right? So today the topic is Yersinia. So Yersinia is belongs to Enterobacteriaceae, and this is a zoonotic disease which is also studied with Pasteurella and Francisella. Like Yersinia consists of three important species, like Yersinia pestis, Yersinia pseudotuberculosis, and Yersinia enterocolitica. And the diseases that are mainly caused is plague in man and rodents. The causative organism is Yersinia pestis. Pseudotuberculosis of animals is caused by pseudotuberculosis, that is, the species of Yersinia is pseudotuberculosis. Gastroenteritis manifestations in man and animals is caused by a species that is Yersinia enterocolitica. So Pasteurella is also a zoonotic disease, but this is not transmitted by rodents. This is due to the bite of your pets like dogs and cats. The bite of this cats and dogs will be infected by Pasteurella, which results in hemorrhagic septicemia, which is the commonest disease. Next, coming to Francisella, this is resulting in the production of a disease known as tularemia. So this Francisella is also a rodent transmitted infection. Today the main topic is Yersinia that we'll proceed on with. So Yersinia is a gram-negative short bacilli. They usually show bipolar staining with methylene blue, and they are primary pathogens of rodents. Rodents are nothing but the animals that belong to Rodentia family, like your rats, mice, squirrels. They all come under this Rodentia. Now coming to bipolar staining, what do you understand by bipolar? Bi is two, poles is towards the two ends. When you consider a bacilli towards the two ends, you will see the staining, and the central portion is not stained, or it is dully stained, which you call it as bipolar staining. And here the staining techniques we'll learn in the next coming slides. So key points to remember about Yersinia is this is a gram-negative short bacilli showing a typical characteristic of bipolar staining. Now coming to the topics that we're going to cover in the next coming slides, it's introduction, morphology, cultural characteristics, biochemical reactions, resistance. We'll learn about the antigens and virulence factors of Yersinia. We'll learn about pathology and pathogenesis. We shall learn about the laboratory diagnosis, prophylaxis, and treatment. And there is a short topic that is included in this, which we call it as Yersiniosis. Now, coming to the introduction, as I tell you always, whenever you learn bacteriology, you try to point it out in short headings, which are these. Now, coming to the genus Yersinia, as I told you in the first beginning slide, Yersinia consists of three medically important species known as Yersinia pestis, which is the causative organism of plague. Yersinia pseudotuberculosis, which produces pseudotuberculosis. Why is it called pseudotuberculosis? I'll tell you in the next coming slides. Coming to Yersinia enterocolitica, this is human diarrheal disease, which is also transmitted by rodents. Now coming to Yersinia pestis, this was formerly known as Pasteurella pestis because this was discovered by Louis Pasteur in the later years. So it was known as Pasteurella pestis. But in the third pandemic episode, two scientists known as Alexander Yersin and Hitasato in 1894, both have discovered this particular organism independently and simultaneously in two different places when the Hong Kong plague was first diagnosed. Now coming to a short picture, that is Alexander Yersin's quarantine station was this. Now the quarantine stations of many, you know what is your quarantine in this current pandemic. If you stay at your home, it is home quarantine. If you stay in a hospital, it is hospital quarantining. This is Alexander Yersin's quarantine station that was in his earlier days when he was working on this particular bacteria known as Yersinia. Now coming to the morphology, it is a short ovoid gram-negative bacilli which measures around 1.5 into 0.7 micrometers in its length and breadth. It shows the rounded ends and convex sides. This may be arranged singly or in short chains or in small groups. Methylene blue stains show bipolar staining, which gives you a typical safety pin appearance. Methylene blue staining, you also call it as Wyon's staining, and you also can do GIMSA staining by this particular to demonstrate this particular organism. Pleomorphism is very common. Usually the old cultures will show the involution forms like coccoid, club shape, filamentous or giant forms. This pleomorphism can be activated, or it can be enhanced in media that consists of 3% sodium chloride. Now coming to the bacterial body, this is surrounded by a thin envelope, which you call it as slime layer, or you call it as capsule. This is a non-motile, non-sparing, and non-acid fast bacteria. So this is the electron micrographic view of Yersinia, which is showing its arrangement either as singles or in short chains or in small groups. So this is the methylene blue staining slide, which is showing this. Here you can see the bacilli in which the two ends are densely or deeply stained and the center one is not stained completely. So this is arranged in short chains. So here also you can see one bacilli. This is seen in short chains or in few groups, or it is also arranged singly like this. Right, so this is the typical safety pin appearance. When you can see the bacteria like this, this is a safety pin appearance of the bacteria, that is both the poles, that is bipolar, two poles are stained and the central portion is clear. So you call it as bipolar staining with methylene blue. So this is the gram staining slide, which shows the gram negative bacilli, and so you call it as safety pin appearance. Now coming to the cultural characteristics of this bacteria, this is aerobic or facultative anaerobic bacteria. This grows fast at temperature of 27 to 30 degrees centigrade. One thing you should remember here is the temperature range of this bacteria is between 2 to 45 degrees. Unlike at 37 degrees centigrade, which is a normal human body temperature where usual pathogens grow, here the bacteria grows best at 27 degrees centigrade. That is, the optimum temperature for this bacteria stands at around 27 degrees centigrade. Why? Because the slime production or the capsule production is good at that particular temperature. So cultural characteristics, remember this current point, that is 27 degrees centigrade is the optimum temperature for Yersinia, unlike other pathogenic bacteria that grows best at 37 degrees centigrade, which is human body temperature. Now coming to the media, it grows on, or it is cultivable in all ordinary media. So on media, that is on nutrient agar, it shows as small, delicate, transparent colonies, and on blood agar, it shows non-hemolytic colonies. So usually the colonies are dark brown in color due to the absorption of hemin pigment when they are grown in blood agar. Coming to the meconchi agar, it produces colorless colonies. In nutrient broth, usually it produces flocculation type of growth. Sometimes a small pellicle may be formed on the surface of your nutrient broth, and sometimes even flocculants may be seen as sediments that are deposited along the sides of the test tube or at the bottom of your test tube. Now coming to an especial media, that is ghee broth, that is when a broth contains around the ghee or oil in it, which you call it as sometimes even clarified butter is added to the broth media to show this growth, which is manifested by, or which is indicated by, stalactite growth. What do you mean by stalactite growth? I'll show you in the next slide. But stalactite growth is nothing but it will be suspended to the bottom. That is, it will hang like a stalactite from the surface of your ghee broth. So which you call it, whenever you put on a liquid and you spray on the fats, then the growth of the media will be to the downs, which you call it as stalactite appearance. So this is the growth of blood agar, which shows your hemin pigmented colonies, that is brown color. So this is the stalactite growth in the ghee broth. When you can see clearly, so this is the surface of your broth on which the clarified butter is added, and the growth is hanging on to the slide like this, which you call it as stalactites. So stalactite growth of the Grieber is the key point which you remember for Yersinia. So whenever in viva voice, if the examiner asks you example of stalactite growth, please remember it is in Yersinia pestis that you see when it is grown in ghee broth or clarified butter broth or oil broth. Now coming to the biochemical reactions, it usually ferments glucose, maltose and mannitol with acid production, but no gas is produced, whereas lactose, sucrose and rhamnose are not fermented by this Yersinia pestis. Now coming to the IMVC reactions, all the reactions are negative except your MR, which is a positive. So IMVC, when it is denoted IMVIC, I is negative, M is positive, V is negative, citrate is negative. So it is minus, plus, minus, minus is your IMVC reactions. It is catalase positive, it is oxidase negative organism, and it is also a urease negative. It has a capability of hydrolyzing esculin, but that is not up to your standards. Just remember, it is IMVC reactions, minus, plus, minus, minus. Catalase is positive, oxidase is positive. Oxidase is negative, urease is negative, and your esculin hydrolysis is positive. Coming to the resistance, it can be easily destroyed by heat, sunlight, drying and chemical disinfectants, destroyed by heat at 55 degrees centigrade and also by 0.5% phenol for 15 minutes. It's viable for long in like cold and moist environments. Usually this bacteria cannot sustain heat. Like strains are laced by specific anti-plague bacteriophages at 22 degrees centigrade. So this is the antigenic structure. So antigens are usually homogeneous and serotypes do not exist for this particular bacteria. So the antigenic structure is complex, which consists of around 20 antigens, and they have been detected by gel diffusion and biochemical analysis. Many of these are claimed to be the virulence factor, out of which the most important one is your fraction one, which is denoted by F1. So this F1 is a heat labile protein envelope antigen, which is best grown or best formed in cultures that are incubated at 37 degrees centigrade. And this inhibits phagocytosis and it is present in almost all the virulent strains. V and W proteins are the second type of antigenic structures. These two are usually always produced together and they also inhibit phagocytosis, and intracellular killing of the bacillus is the key role that is played by V and W proteins. Now coming to bacteriocin, we also call it as pesticin 1 or fibrinolysin or coagulase. So these strains are mostly inhibiting the Yersinia pseudotuberculosis, Enterocolitica and E. coli. So last two, that is endotoxin and murine toxin, these two we call them as plague toxins. Plague toxins, endotoxin, which is a lipopolysaccharide, this is almost similar to that of the endotoxin of enteric bacilli. So endotoxin is a lipopolysaccharide, which is similar to the endotoxin of enteric bacillus. Now coming to the murine toxin, this is usually active in rats and mice, but no role is seen in humans. As they both are related in plague manifestations, we call these two toxins as plague toxins. Now coming to the biotypes of Yersinia pestis, this is an important table, just try to remember it and recollect. So we have three biovarieties or biotypes, that is Yersinia pestis variety is medievalis. So there are two reactions which we take to classify these. That is glycerol fermentation is positive for medievalis and nitrate reduction is negative. This glycerol fermentation and nitrate reduction, if you can see it, Yersinia pestis medievalis has positive negative. Yersinia pestis variety antica have both the positive reactions. Yersinia pestis variety orientalis does not have glycerol fermentation, but has the capacity to have nitrate reduction. So it is medievalis plus minus, Antica plus plus, Orientalis is minus and plus. Here you should remember one more thing, that is Ersinia pestis variety, that is Medivalis, was the most ancient biotype that was discovered for Ersinia pestis, that was causative organism for Justinian plague, which was seen in 541 AD. Whereas coming to Ersinia pestis variety Antica, here the term called as black death arrived. The infection that is produced by Ersinia pestis, we also call it as black death. So the term came into usage after this biotype discovery, that is Antica, which was responsible for European plague, which was seen in 14th century. So Ersinia pestis variety Antica is having glycerol fermentation and nitrate reduction positivity, which is denoted in the, that is you call it as second pandemic of plague, that is European plague, which was seen in 14th century. Now coming to Ersinia pestis variety Orientalis, this is the most ancient form of or ancient biotype that was discovered. In this, you have seen that this was most recent years, that is in 1984 or 1916, this particular pandemic started. It was also seen in India, Asia, that is Hong Kong, China and India were the most affected areas by this particular biovariety known as Ersinia pestis variety Orientalis. So try to remember this, that is Ersinia pestis medievalis, Justinian plague in 541 AD. This is just an epidemiological introduction that I am giving you. Ersinia pestis variety Antica, this is seen in Europe in between 14th century, that is 1400 years. Ersinia pestis Orientalis is seen in 1900s. So most common affected areas are Hong Kong, India and China. So in Asia was almost all included for this pandemic of Orientalis biotype. Now coming to the pathogenesis and pathology. So plague is a zoonotic disease, as I told you earlier. This is transmitted by rodents. As I told you, rodents are nothing but the family of or the animals that belong to Rodentia, which includes your mice, squirrels or chipmunks. Like infection is transmitted from one animal to the other by the bite of infected rat flea, which you call it as Xenophila siopis. I'll show you the image. We also have it in our college. You can see the slide once you are back to college in your regular periods. So infection is transmitted from one animal to another by the bite of infected rat flea, which you call it as Xenophila siopis. We have two natural cycles that are exhibited by a plague, which we call it as urban plague, which is transmitted between man and rodents, wild or sylvatic plague. This urban plague, we also call it as domestic plague. Why? Because by the common domestic rats, what we see, the life cycle happens between the man and the rodent, that is rat. We call it as urban plague or domestic plague. Wild or sylvatic plague, this is seen in wild rodents like mice, squirrels and chipmunks. So this we call it as wild or sylvatic plague. I'll tell you the life cycle in the next slide. So the incubation period of this infection is around 2 to 6 days. So this is the brief introduction. As I told you, wild rodent cycle, this happens between the wild rodents like mice, squirrels and chipmunks. That is, by the bite of the flea, the wild rodent acquires infection and flea again bites the other wild rodent and the life cycle goes on like this. Whereas in domestic, here the relation between man occurs. Even from the wild rodents, when the bite of flea occur in man, it results in the production of this disease known as bubonic plague. Domestic rodents, that is your rats, here also the disease is transmitted by flea, that is Xenophila coccid, and this is transmitted to humans. So in human, the manifestations I'll tell you in the next slide. That is nothing but your bubonic, pneumonic and septicemic, I'll tell you in the next slides. So remember this life cycle, that is you have two stages, that is wild cycle and also domestic cycle. Wild cycle is between your wild rodents like your mice, squirrels and chipmunks, which is transmitted by the bite of flea to humans. Domestic cycle is between your rat, flea and humans. So this is the image of your mice, squirrels and chipmunks. These are nothing but your wild rodents. So this is Xenophila cheops, which we call it as rat flea, the causative organism of this disease. So before we go into the plague in detail, I just want to tell you a brief introduction about what is happening when the disease is produced. As I told you, this particular infection is transmitted by your fleas. So the natural parasites are rodents. So infection is transmitted among rats by the bite of rat flea. So fleas, how are they acquiring infection? As they feed on the infected rat, they acquire the infection. And in fleas, bacteria multiply in the stomach that they block the proventriculus of the Xenophila, that is your rat flea. And one point you should remember here is the interval between the ingestion of infected blood and the blocking of proventriculus in your rat flea, it is known as extrinsic incubation period. Try to remember, extrinsic incubation period is from the time of bite of the rat, that is infected rat, the time the flea have bitten it and the growth of the bacteria that has occurred in its mouth, that you call it as proventriculus, you call it as extrinsic incubation period. And this is usually that takes around 2 weeks. And after this proventriculus is blocked, when it bites human, what happens is this proventriculus is blocked by the excessive growth of bacteria, and this bacteria cannot be pushed out of the mouth. So what it takes is when it tries to take the blood meal on the human body, so when it just tries to suck it, it can't take in. So the bacteria that are present in the proventriculus are mixed with the blood of the human when it is trying to bite. So that is how the bacteria enters the human body. So this is a brief introduction, that is the brief introductory cycle that happens in the rat flea before it is producing the infection in humans. So as it is biting the infected rat, it is taking the bacteria, and the bacteria are excessively grown in the stomach and they're blocking the proventriculus. And when proventriculus is blocked, when it tries to feed on the new human and it cannot transfer the bacteria out, so when it is trying to just push the bacteria out, it gets mixed with the blood, and that is how the human has acquired infection. So the plague usually occurs in 3 forms, that is bubonic plague, pneumonic plague, and septicemic plague. Remember, this usually comes as a short note question in your exams. So remember, bubonic plague, pneumonic plague, and septicemic plague. Bubonic plague. So usually this bubonic plague, why you call it as bubon or bubonic plague is, this bubonic plague is usually seen in the groin region. So bubos is nothing but your groin. So bubon, why is it happening in the groin region is, when the flea bites the leg, it usually involves the inguinal lymph nodes and infecting the groin region. So you call it as bubonic plague or bubos. So this is the incubation period. As usual, it is 2 to 5 days. The lymph nodes get drained at the site of entry when the bacilli become infected. And in some infections, the infection is localized to a particular site, that is most commonly at the bite of rat flea, which you call it as pestis minor. So plague enters, as I told you, through the bite of the flea, and which is manifested by high fever and painful lymphadenopathy, which shows enlarged or tender lymph nodes, which we call it as bubos. Remember this bubos, because this will come even in sample collection. Right, lymph nodes, they become enlarged and separated. So usually the lymph nodes involved are groin and axilla, as I told you. An infection often reaches the bloodstream and gets widely disseminated, causing intravascular coagulation that may lead to gangrene of skin, fingers, and penis. And this is the chief characteristic feature. Why we call this particular infection as black death is because of this intravascular coagulation that is occurring, that is disseminated intravascular coagulation that is occurring. The gangrene of the skin occurs, which results in darkening of the body, and the dead body of this bubonic plague patient is very much dark in color, and the patient dies with vomiting of blood. So that is the reason we coined this term as black death. So gangrene of skin, fingers and penis is seen due to disseminated intravascular coagulation. So these are the lymph nodes which are usually, that is, this is axillary, this is inguinal, this is cervical lymph nodes, which are included for or involved in this bubonic plague. Now coming to the pneumonic plague usually never appears as a primary condition. This is seen usually during bubonic plague epidemics, but primary pneumonic plague happened in Manchuria, that is in 1910 to 1912. That is it claimed around 60,000 deaths. So the spread of this pneumonic plague is by droplet infection. So the bacilli spread through the lungs that produce the hemorrhagic pneumonia. So cyanosis is very prominent here, and bloody mucoid specimen expectorant is containing bacilli, which are enormous in number, is the chief characteristic feature of this pneumonic plague. Pneumonic plague is highly infectious, and in untreated patients, it is almost leading to death. So it is a highly infectious form of plague that is resulting due to the inhalation of infective droplets. Can occur as a secondary to bubonic plague. It's always fatal. Fever, hemorrhagic consolidation, cough with expectoration, cyanosis, sepsis, and death are the chief characteristic features. Now coming to septicemic plague, this may occur as primary infection or occur as a terminal event of your bubonic and pneumonic plagues. So the massive involvement of the blood vessels that occur in hemorrhages and also disseminated intravascular coagulation, which results in the necrosis. So you can see the darkening here. So the whole body, wherever the infection happens, the whole skin becomes dark. That is the reason we call it as black death. So due to this manifestation, the disease is given the name as black death. So remember, so whenever black death comes, try to write the plague. So other blacks, what you remember in microbiology, just to recollect, black water fever comes in Plasmodium malariae, falciparum. And another black what you remember is your black bane, that is seen in anthrax. If you remember in Woolsworth's disease, you'll have black bane. Black water fever is falciparum, that is malaria. So remember this, black death is mainly due to Yersinia. Don't get confused, black death is Yersinia pestis. Black water fever is Plasmodium falciparum. Black bane is anthrax. Now coming to the laboratory diagnosis, we have two here, that is by direct observation and indirect. So direct is whenever you can see the bacteria, you call it as direct demonstration. So direct demonstration happen by three. That is microscopy, cultural techniques, and third is animal inoculation. So the direct demonstration of your parasite happens by microscopy, culture, and animal inoculation. That we're going to learn now. So the gram-stained smear of sputum and aspirate from lymph node shows gram-negative bacilli. Methylene blue stained smear shows bacilli with typical bipolar staining, as I have shown you when I was telling about the morphology. The buffy coat smears of the blood from septicemic cases show plague bacilli. The fluorescent antibody technique in impression films demonstrate F1 antigen. So the culture, we have already discussed, and I was telling you about the cultural characteristics. It can be done on all ordinary media, and the growth characteristics I have already given you in the earlier slides. So the culture on blood agar, it is incubated at 27 degrees centigrade. And ghee broth, as I told you, you should remember always that it produces stalactite kind of growth. So this is the gram staining, which is showing the gram negative bacteria. That is two poles. If you can see that these two ends are stained darkly, and the center portion is not stained or dully stained. So this is the blood film, that is methylene blue staining. which is showing your bipolar staining here also. You can see the center portion is not stained and the ends or the two poles are darkly stained, which you call it as bipolar. So this is the blood film that is taken, which shows the infective plague bacilli. So this is the fluorescent antibody technique that is like impression films are being taken by the tissues, and F1 antigen is demonstrated by this and fluorescent antibody technique, which you can see the presence of plague bacilli. So this is the fluorescent staining slide. Now coming to the animal inoculation, as I told you, culture, you can take the buboes or spleen or heart blood or bone marrow, or you can even take the decomposed carcasses and go for cultural techniques, where you can see the growth of the bacteria on various media, what we have studied earlier, right? So coming to the animal inoculation, the animals that are usually used are guinea pigs and white rats. The inoculum is the exudate from buboes or 24 hours broth culture is taken. So inoculum here is for animal inoculation, but the specimens what we usually collect for this laboratory diagnosis is as the symptoms manifested. For example, in bubonic plague, buboes are collected. For pneumonic plague, sputum is collected. And for septicemic plague, blood is collected. So try to remember before going to animal inoculation for cultural techniques, like regular culture techniques, for bubonic, buboes are collected. For pneumonic, sputum is collected. For septicemic, blood is collected, right? So coming to animal inoculation, animals, that is guinea pig or white rats, are taken. Inoculum, as I told you, the exudate from buboes. The route of inoculation is by subcutaneous injection. Animal dies within 2 to 5 days. So the postmortem of this animal reveals local inflammatory reaction. You can observe necrosis and edema. The lymph nodes are enlarged and congested. The organism is like demonstrable. You can see local lesions, that is viscera, and heart blood can show the bacteria present in that. Now coming to the indirect demonstration, that is by antigen detection or serological test. What we do is F1 glycoprotein antigen is demonstrable by immunofluorescence and ELISA. As I tell you in the class, write ELISA, marks are given. Like serological test, antibody to F1 antigen may be detected by passive hemagglutination testing or complement fixation testing. The diagnostic titer should be 1 in 16 or more than that. So that is the serological indication, that is F1 antigen may be detected like this. And the titer of antibody should be more than 1 in 16, which is the significant titer. Now, coming to the diagnosis of plague in rats, why do you think that it is important to diagnose rats in order to tell whether this is a real pandemic that have occurred due to rats or not? You should diagnose it with rats even. So, rat diets of plague may carry this infection. So this infected fleas may transmit the infection to others. So in order to prevent that, even the rats that are died should be diagnosed of plague before discarding them, right? So how do you eliminate the fleas before you collect this rat? Simple spraying of kerosene over it will discard or will just remove all the fleas. And the carcass, that is the dead rat, should be dipped in 3% Lysol to destroy the ectoparasites that are present. So the autopsies are taken by the buboes that are present in the rat, where it will be manifested by enlarged lymph nodes. We can see pleural effusion. We can see the enlargement of spleen, hemorrhages under the skin and internal organs. And specimens like heart blood, lymph nodes, and spleen can be collected. So spleen is usually enlarged and molded over the stomach with granules, and nodules can also be seen. So pleural effusion may be clearly observed with abundant and straw colored and less oftenly blood stained effusion can be taken out from the lungs in rats. Now coming to the prophylaxis, we have general measures, that is control of fleas and rodents. So how do we control the fleas? That is insecticides, DDT. As I told you in the earlier slide, that is how before we diagnose the rat with this plague, we are trying to spray kerosene or trying to dip it in 3% Lysol. So control of fleas in the society can be done by insecticides or spraying of DDT. Now, control of rats by rodenticides. The first slide, Martin rat kill is your rodenticide. So the rat kill should be given so that it controls the rat. Now, what are the specific measures we take? We have two types of vaccines, that is killed vaccine and live vaccines. So live vaccines are no longer recommended because they are producing some adverse reactions. Now coming to the killed vaccines, they are used for active immunization. That is, they are used in India. Usually they are prepared in Hafkins Institute, which is present and located in Mumbai. And they use usually whole culture antigens in that. So the virulent strains of plague bacilli is grown in casein hydrolysate broth for around 2 to 4 weeks at 32 degrees centigrade and killed by 0.05% of formaldehyde. And they are preserved with phenyl mercuric nitrate. So this is how the vaccine is prepared. That is, the virulent strain of plague bacilli is grown in casein hydrolysate broth for around 2 to 4 weeks at 32 degrees centigrade and killed with 0.05% formaldehyde and preserved with phenyl mercuric nitrate. So the vaccine is usually administered subcutaneously and two doses are given at the intervals of 1 to 3 months, which followed by third dose, that is given at the end of 6 months. So vaccination gives protection against the bacteria, that is your bubonic plague, but not pneumonic plague. So protection does not last for more than 6 months. An attack of plague usually provides more lasting immunity than your vaccines. So vaccines are usually recommended for persons who are exposed occupationally or who are exposed to infection. So that is usually the people who work in plague laboratories, the hospital personnel, the troops that are deployed in known plague areas are usually administered with this particular vaccines. So no value in plague outbreaks and massive vaccination is not at all advised for this particular plague. So this killed vaccines are used for active immunization. The virulent strains of casein hydrolysate broth, they're killed by 0.05% formaldehyde preserved by phenyl mercuric nitrate, and vaccine consists of around 2000 million organisms per ml. So dose schedule I have told you already. The live vaccines are not given. Chemoprophylaxis, usually cotrimoxazole or tetracycline. Orally it is given, that is 500 mg, 6th hourly for at least 5 days or for 1 week is the chemoprophylaxis that is given against this particular infection. Now coming to the treatment, the early diagnosis and antibiotics usually reduce the plague mortality from 30 to 100% to 5 to 10%. Streptomycin, doxycycline, chloramphenicol are the effective drugs which are effective against active infection. But plasmid-borne resistance, that is antibiotic resistance, was reported in Madagascar in 1995. Now coming to Ersiniosis. So what do you understand by Ersiniosis? Ersiniosis is also a short notes question, just try to remember. So infection with Ersinia, that other than Ersinia pestis, as I discussed, three species of Ersinia, that is Ersinia pestis, Ersinia pseudotuberculosis, and Ersinia enterocolitica, other than Ersinia pestis, two species, that is Ersinia pseudotuberculosis and Ersinia enterocolitica, this particular infection you call it as Ersiniosis. This is either acquired accidentally or from the disease cycles of either wild or domestic animals. First, we shall learn about Yersinia pseudotuberculosis. This is responsible for production or causation of pseudotuberculosis. Usually, guinea pigs, rabbits, birds are susceptible. The ingestion of materials contaminated with animal feces leads to human infection. So the poor growth is seen on Mekongi agar. Its motility is seen at 22 degrees centigrade and not at 37 degrees centigrade. So just try to remember this point here. And this particular organism has the capacity to produce urease. As I told you in Yersinia pestis that it is urease negative, here the chief characteristic feature is Yersinia pseudotuberculosis is urease positive. And rhamnos and melobios are also fermented in pseudotuberculosis. So these two points are differentiated from Yersinia pestis. So try to remember them. So we have around 6 serological groups based on somatic and flagellar antigen. So usually the cross-relation occurs between Yersinia pestis as well as Salmonella. So for diagnosis, what you will take here is, so blood, stool and lymph node aspirates are obtained from cultures on standard media. The mode of infection of these animals is by ingestion or alimentary tag. So infected guinea pigs, the liver, the spleen, lung shows multiple nodules that resemble that of the nodules of tuberculosis. So multiple nodules resembling the tuberculosis is the chief distinguishing character. So that is the reason the name pseudotuberculosis have come for this particular bacteria. So mode of infection in animals is by ingestion or alimentary tract. So infected guinea pigs, rabbits, birds will have multiple nodules resembling tuberculosis, hence the name as pseudotuberculosis. Now coming to Yersinia enterocolitica. This enterocolitica, this also resembles almost like pseudotuberculosis. This is also motile at 22 degrees centigrade. It ferments sucrose and cellobios and decarboxylate ornithin. So this is the chief characteristic feature of Yersinia enterocolitica. Here, the many strains are indole positive and BP positive. In Yersinia pestis, I have told you that in MVIC reactions, only methyl red is positive. Whereas Yersinia enterocolitica, we will see indole is positive and Voges Proscor is positive and citrate is negative. So here the reactions are plus, plus, minus, minus. So here enterocolitica, remember indole is positive and BP is positive. Here also we have 6 biotypes that are identified in the culture based on the biochemical characteristics and cultural characteristics. So more than 60 O serotypes have been reported. The most human isolates, they belong to O3, O8 and O9. So serological cross reactions occur between O9 serotypes and Brucella strains. Brucella we will learn in the next coming classes. So the cross reaction of pseudotuberculosis is between Salmonella and Yersinia pestis, whereas here it is between Brucella and O9. So this particular infection, we have 3 types of human diseases that have been known. That is gastroenteritis, or we also call it as enterocolitis. This is usually a self-limiting gastroenteritis which is seen in young individuals, that is in young children. It may be an inflammatory type or non-inflammatory type of gastroenteritis. Coming to mesenteric lymphadenitis, we also call it as mesenteroadenitis or inflammatory terminal ileitis. This is usually seen in older children, which mimics appendicitis. And finally is septicemia. So septicemia, we will see in adults, which is characterized by bacteremia, meningitis, and arthralgia or erythema nodosum. This is not of much like important for you. Just remember, gastroenteritis is seen in young. This is in old children, which is mimicking the appendicitis. And septicemia, it is usually seen In people who have HLA-B27 group of antigens in them. Now, that much clarity is not required. Just remember, Yersinia enterocolitis produces gastroenteritis, dysenteric lymphadenitis, and septicemia. So this is about the final thing. Just try to remember the distinguishing features between three species of Yersinia. That is Yersinia pestis, motility not seen, pseudotuberculosis at 22 degrees centigrade, and enterocolitica at 22 degrees centigrade, it is motile. So I'm just trying to summarize the biochemical reactions of all the three species. Yersinia pestis, pseudotuberculosis, enterocolitica. Motility at 22 degrees centigrade, not seen in pestis, whereas positive in pseudotuberculosis and enterocolitica. Fermentation of sugars, your sucrose, rhamnose, and melibios. Yersinia pestis do not ferment any of these three sugars. Whereas pseudotuberculosis ferments sucrose, rhamnose, and melibios. Whereas enterocolitica does not ferment any of these three sugars again. So just remember, pseudotuberculosis only ferments your sucrose, rhamnose, and melibios. Urease is negative for pestis, whereas positive for pseudotuberculosis and enterocolitica. Ornithine decarboxylase is not seen for pestis and pseudotuberculosis, whereas positive for enterocolitica. So please remember this. So this will make your biochemical reactions to remember easily. So Imbic reactions, I forgot to add here. So Imbic reactions, it is minus, plus, minus, minus for Yersinia pestis. Yersinia tuberculosis, there's no much variation between pestis and tuberculosis because they both are cross-reacting. And enterocolitica, we have plus, plus, minus, minus. So thank you. And this is the rat or mice that have killed many of the people. So we do have foci. In India also, we have four foci for pandemic. So be careful for this corona pandemic also, and take care. Thank you.